Queuing theory actually is one of the most important techniques for experiment for computer science analysis. In fact, if you see the books on performance analysis, they are sometimes, oftentimes, just totally one thing, which is queuing theory. That's it. So this is a very popular way to do analysis. And so we will talk about that. And so in this particular chapter, we will talk about four things. How do you notate a queue? And what are the rules which apply to all the queues? Then the Little's law, which is one of the fundamental laws of queuing theory, and the stochastic processes. So actually, when you have a queue, before you go into computer, you can just think about the banking queue, or you think about the grocery store queue, or you know, Walmart queue, or wherever you go to stand in a queue. There are several things you have to know, you have to find out. First of all, number one item is arrival process. How are the people coming in? Okay. If they're coming in a whole group, like in the morning of Black Friday, that's a different arrival process than any other day, right? So the different queuing and response time and all that. Second thing you have to do is service time distribution. How are they being served? So, if everybody has one or two items, that is a different kind of thing than if you have everybody has big cards, you know, things like that. Service time. Third thing is number of servers. How many lanes are open? Right? Fourth is how many people can stand in the queue? Now, remember in our whole discussion throughout this whole part, most of the rest of the course, when we say waiting position, these people who are being served are also waiting. They're not out yet. All right? And so that causes some confusion. So this is actually, here's the thing. Let me not call them waiting position. They're basically, when you say size of the queue includes both this and that. Waiting might be, actually, so we will see. So this is waiting, this is being served, the total is queue. All right. And the first thing is the population size. People are not in the queue. So they are outside, maybe in the parking lot, at homes, or anything like that. Who are the potential customers? Right? That is the population size. Now, why are all these important? Because if your population size is very small, let's say we are talking about a very special store, let's say a store knitting store. Population size is small. People who are interested in knitting, the queues might be small. On the other hand, if you talk about Best Buy or anything else which is electronics, everybody is interested in, or maybe we are biased, you know, so then the queues might be larger. So population size affects. Now, all of this applies to computer systems. Why? Because everywhere in the computer systems, we have more than one process running. We have processor queued at the CPU, we have the process queued at the disk, we have processors queued in the network. So there are so many queues everywhere that we need to analyze all this, right? Now, the important thing is that finite buffer size, is not infinite. In the computers, basically in the real world as well, if the number of jobs who want to get that resource is larger than some amount, then we just drop them. In Walmart, they start shooting each other, actually, on the Black Friday. You know? So they want to analyze this kind of queue. So here's the thing. So when you want to notate a queue, you have to tell me all these six things. Sixth one is service discipline. How are they being served? First come, first served, or the heaviest person served first? That discipline also applies, the loudest first. Whoever shouts and gets the service first, come on. You know, things like that, right? So that has to be explained. And so Kendall made a notation, which is called Kendall notation, ASMVKD. A is the arrival process, S is the service time distribution, M is the number of servers, B is the number of buffers, K is the population size, and SD is the service discipline. And an example would be, and actually we will go through each of those first, one by one. Arrival processes, the way you do arrival processes, you find find out what is the distribution of inter-arrival times. So, you sit down at the front, you stand at the front, and you note down the time. Somebody came at 10 o'clock. Somebody came at 10:35. So, the inter-arrival time is 35 minutes. Right? We are not interested in absolute time, we are interested in inter-arrival times. So, if we note down the time T1, T2, Tj as the arrival times, then tau j is Tj minus Tj minus 1. Tau j is the inter-arrival time. And the tau j is from the assume. Okay, we assume for most of the continuum theory analysis that they are IID. They are identically and independently, they are independent and identically distributed. So, if I know that the first customer came in 35 minutes, I cannot say anything about the next customer. I mean, well, basically, the thing is that they are independent, right? We can say something in a minute, but basically they are independent and identically distributed, same distribution. If that distribution is memoryless, that means exponential. Suppose the inter-arrival times, you plot their histogram, and you find out it is exponential, right? Then we can prove that it is memoryless, and I will prove that in later slides. Right now, let's just assume that this is true. Memoryless means like this following property, is that bus arrival, for example, is a good case. But inter-bus arrival times you found out is exponentially distributed. Then you are standing at the bus stand and you ask somebody, how long have you been standing? He says, I've been here for an hour. All right. So now you think that since he has been waiting for an hour, maybe the bus will come. Right? But you cannot say anything better than he could have said 1 hour before. That means knowing the past history does not help predicting the future. That is called memoryless. Memoryless means history does not help. Okay? So, if the distribution is such, then you can prove that the inter-arrival times will be exponentially distributed. So, this is a sufficient and necessary condition. They will be exponentially distributed, and so we notate that arrival process by M, not by E. Okay? All others are denoted by their names. For example, Erlang distribution, if the inter-arrival times have Erlang distribution, then we say E. If it is hyper-exponential, we say H. If it is deterministic or constant, we say D. If it is general, means it could be any distribution, we say G. Alright? So, before I go into more, basically you must have heard the term like MM1Q. M. So, the first M is the arrival process. And in MM1Q, that M indicates that the inter-arrival times are memoryless. Okay? M is for memoryless. Then we go to service time distribution. For the being served, again, we see when, for example, the time at each station is spent at the terminal. If you go to a terminal room and the student log on to the computer and then get out, if somebody measured it, it could be, you know, basically an example of service time distribution, right? The service times we are assuming, generally assume that to be IID. IID means independent and identically distributed. Again, the distribution could be M, E, H, D, or G. What is M? Memoryless, E is for Erlang, G, H for hyper, exponential, and D for deterministic, G for general. And buffer for the waiting positions. Okay, so now we go into the service discipline. Service discipline most commonly is first come, first served, FCFS. Sometimes it is last come, first served, like in a stack, or in 911 calls. Okay, in 911 calls, what is happening right now is more important than what happened 10 minutes ago. Okay? So, and R to be last come first served with preempt and resume. Preempt means you stop what you are doing and do this thing which has come new. When you are done with the new stuff, then you go back to the old stuff. okay? Then round robin, you just go in around and around and around, right? Small quantum processor sharing. So if you do round robin with a very small quantum, so you do 1 microsecond, 1 microsecond, or 1 millisecond, 1 millisecond, 1 millisecond, you do that, that looks like continuous, you know, service, that would be processor sharing. Infinite server is fixed delay. So you go there and it looks like there are infinite servers, so you never find a queue. You just go there and you find the server empty, you go to the server and server takes some time, that is called infinite server. The delay is fixed. Shortest processing time first. So you find out all the people are waiting, who has the smallest number, please come on down, we'll serve you first. Okay, and that is done in the disk, by the way. When we have the disk, we look at the position X in the rotating disk. We ask, you want to go to position Y, you want to go to position Z, you want to go to sector number 35, you want to go to sector number 3000, who is the closest to this position? Okay, shortest processing time first. Shortest remaining processing time first. Now, if the jobs can be preempted and resumed, then we'll worry about remaining time. Shortest expected processing time first. So that is basically the proof forecasting. Shortest expected remaining processing time first, and then biggest queue first. That's in the world. If you go to, I haven't seen this that much in another state, but you go to other countries, people don't stand in the queue, they just come in the front, and whoever has the biggest, they get in there first, right? So the biggest third first, and then the loudest voice first. In the meetings, this is very common. You're holding your hand, but they don't look at your hand, they look at your voice. Whoever speaks gets the chance to speak first, right? And so this is not the complete list, by the way. You can come up with more. So an example is a queue could be 1500 FCF. What that means is that the arrival time is and the service time is memory less. And how many servers? 3 servers. How many buffers? 20 buffers. And 1500 is the population size and FCFS. And FCFS is first come first served. Is the discipline. Alright? Now, here's the thing. There are certain things which are default. If they're default, we don't indicate it. For example, if it is FCFS, we don't have to tell the world. Right? This is 99.9% time is FCFS. We just don't write it. Okay? Population size is generally infinite, so we don't write it. Alright, if you don't see any population size, that means it is infinite. Buffer size is generally infinite, and if it is infinite, you don't write it. Nobody is shooting anybody, nobody is getting dropped, nobody is getting killed, so we just leave that unspecified. Now, the first three things are always specified, because we don't know how many servers there are and whether it is exponential or not, and so on and so forth. So those are the ones that you see most often. So you might see GG1 means GG1 plus infinite buffers, infinite population size, and first come first serve. Okay? Any questions? Alright, here's a quiz. And the quiz means you do it in your homework right now. This is live quiz. So please do it. And I will give you 2 minutes actually to do it quickly. True or false? The number of servers in an MM13 queue is whatever. Please write down in your notes. Right, Dan? Answer. The number of servers in a queue is 3. Right, 1, 3, right? No, 1, false. And have you got that false? GG1 is like a stack, LCFS, 2. MD33 has 30 buffers, 2. GG1 has infinite population size, 2. And GD1 has first come, first serve, 2. Everybody got that, right? Okay, all right, next. Now let's see what is this memoryless stuff. So exponential distribution, and we skipped this whole chapter on distribution. There is chapter 28 or something like that, which we don't have to teach because it is a reference chapter. You go alphabetically on all the distributions. So in that you will find exponential distribution. And so the exponential distribution has this density function and this cumulative distribution function. The mean is A, the variance is A squared. The coefficient of variation is 1. So this is all you can find in that chapter. The main thing is that expected time to next arrival is always A, regardless of the time since the last arrival. So I haven't proven it here, but I have proved somewhere else. But basically what it is saying is that if you knew that x is more than 5, somebody told you that, tell me what the value of x is, exponential of x is, if x is more than 5. You know, I've been waiting for 5 minutes, you know, what is the expected value? The answer is still the same as it was at x equal to 0. I mean, basically. So it doesn't depend upon the limit, right? So the expected time in the next arrival is always A, regardless of the time since the last arrival. So then in the past, it still doesn't help. Erlang distribution, on the other hand, is simply, if you put lots of exponential servers in a series, then that becomes Erlang. The total sum becomes Erlang. So this Erlang distribution is simply the sum of exponentials. Okay, and it has a probability density functions and everything else. Hyper exponential distribution is if you put a lot of servers in parallel, then the net effect that you get is hyper exponential. Okay, where you go to each of these with a probability p1, p2, p3, p5. So whatever is coming in, and then you do that, then this would be hyper exponential. If you have servers which are parallel, so if you take the surface time distribution for this kind of thing, that would be hyper exponential distribution. All right. Now, then there is a group arrival. Sometimes people come in a group or jobs come in a group. And that is denoted by a superscript. So you put that like this, M raised to square bracket X square bracket closed, where X denotes is the group size. So GX, G sub X would be the same thing, the general processing time. For example, MX, M1. That means single server, memoryless bulk arrivals. Now, I am using another word here, Poisson arrivals. So that's just another name for exponential distributed inter-arrival time. So let me tell you why Poisson. If the inter-arrival times have exponential distribution, then the number of arrivals in any interval has a Poisson distribution. That's the relationship between the two distributions by definition. So we also call them Poisson arrivals. We can call them memoryless, we can call them exponential, we can call them Poisson. Do you understand that? What is Poisson here? Poisson is the number of arrivals. And what is exponential? Exponential is the inter-arrival times. And what is memoryless? Memoryless is the time to the next, expected time to the next arrival. Okay? So this is that. And GXM, similarly, that the service is group. No, service is done in a group. You know, you go to photo studio and they call the whole family, come on, sit down. That's a group service. All right. Next quiz. Now do it in your thing, and I will give you a minute maybe at most, and then we can go through the answer. Okay. The answers are: exponential distribution is denoted as n. Hyper exponential is the one where you have parallelism, right? Parallel exponential service. And Erlang is the one where you have Erlang with k equal to 1 is same as. Anybody get that one? Okay. But if you have series, if you have just one, then that is exponential. Right. Similarly, if I would have done a hyper exponential, if you had just one, hk, if you had h1, h1 is same as exponential. All right. Now that we understand how to denote the q, now what are we going to compute? So there are several input and output variables. So first thing we use is, we already know m, little m is the number of servers. Mu is the service rate, and lambda is the arrival rate. Now we confuse people a lot by using different terms. So now we said inter-arrival times. First we said inter-arrival times, and we said inter-arrival time distribution. But in analysis, we are going to do only arrival rate, lambda. Now what is the rate? The inter-arrival time is 5 minutes, and the rate is 1/5 per minute. Okay. And so when we say lambda, lambda is the arrival rate. How many arrives per day? Mu is the service rate. And then we are going to compute how many people are being served, that is NS, that is a random number, and how many people, and I have to change this notation. And W, how many people are waiting. The total is the number in the queue. If you have an extra handout, I want to make that notation clear, because that and queue is confusing. So this is number waiting, this is number being served, and this is the total in the queue. So this is the waiting time, this is the service time, this is the total response time. All right. So those are the things. Yeah. Okay. So the key variables are tau is the inter arrival time, mean arrival rate is 1/e tau, s is the service time, d service rate is 1/es, total service time is m mu. So that's another thing you have to remember, that service rate is per server. Mu is per server. If you have m servers, then the total service rate is m mu. And in the number of jobs in the system, number of jobs in the system is also called number in the queue, or number queue length, sorry, not queue length. So queue length includes the job currently receiving service as well as those waiting in the queue. I will, as I said, I would rather use N sub W right now. In this addition, we have N Q as the number of jobs waiting, and S number of jobs receiving service, and so on and so forth, W. All right. There are some rules which are for all the queues. One rule is that for every queue, lambda must be less than m mu for stability. What does stability means? That the queue doesn't keep going up forever. If lambda is greater than or equal to m mu, this is a very strict condition, by the way. Remember this one. This is lambda has to be less than m mu. If it is greater than or equal to mu, then the queues can overflow. regardless of what your buffer size is. So the only exceptions are finite population or finite buffer systems. All right. Why finite population? Because in the finite population, suppose if you have population of 1500, all 50 data would come in and there is no overflow. Right? Our finite buffer system, basically you have defined as to what you are saying, your queue is, will never exceed the number of buffers. People might die, but basically that is stable. Instability means infinite queue. Sufficient but not necessary, because DD1 is stable at lambda equal to mu. So DD1, anybody knows what is a DD1 queue? What is D for? Deterministic constant. So you have constant arrival time. So for example, every 5 seconds somebody is coming in. And every 5 seconds somebody is leaving. Right? Then the even though lambda is equal to mu, the queue is stable. In other cases, the queue will not be stable in equality. The only exception for equality is DD1 queue. Number in the system versus number in the queue, the number in the system is n, is always add up. And since they add up, random number, the means also add up. However, the variances don't add up. Variances will add up only if the service is independent of the number in the queue. Right? That means that, and this may not be true in practice. In practice, if the queue becomes very large, the servers may start working faster. Right? If that is the case, that is the load dependent server. And if it is not, then variance can be added. Number versus time. And so this is the thing, is that number, if the jars are not large in sufficient buffer, mean number of jars in the system is equal to the average time in this function. I will leave that alone for the time being, but that is the Little's law. And I think I have a whole slide on Little's law. So I'm, for the time being, let's just say this is one of the biggest laws. Is that mean number of jobs in the system is not trivial actually to understand why this is the case. But you want to find out how many people are inside, you can just measure the arrival rate and you can measure the mean response time. Response time is the one going in, the total time they spend in the system is the response time. Right? So you can stand outside the system, find out what is the arrival rate, what is the response time, and you can find out how many people are inside. Right, that is the Little's law. And this Little's law actually applies to anything in the system, including in the queue. If you were applied to the queue, then the mean number of jobs waiting is equal to arrival rate times mean waiting time. So this is the Little's law, and this is one of the fundamental laws of queuing theory, and therefore we spend a little bit more time later on. Time in system versus time in queue. So we know that the waiting time plus service time is equal to the response time. These are random numbers, they add up, and therefore their means add up. So mean response time is mean waiting time plus mean service time, but their variances won't. Variances will add up only if they are independent. That means the covariance of WNS is zero. And so that's it, basically. All right? Three. Just quickly fill it out, please. I give you a minute. Then, okay, here's the answer. If a queue has two servers waiting for the service, then the number in the system is not 2, it is plus 2. Where n is the number of servers. Did you specify how many servers are there? Right? If the arrival rate is 2 yards per second, then the mean the arrival time is 1 upon 2. That is good. That's easy. If there are 3 server queue, then the arrival rate at 1 yards per second, the service time should be less than 3. Basically, m mu. Lambda should be less than m mu. Okay? Alright. A little flaw. Little flaw says that the mean number in the system is equal to the arrival rate times the mean response time. And interesting is that relation applies to all systems or all parts of a system in which the number of jobs entering is equal to the number of those completing the service. As long as you don't kill people inside a box, this rule will apply. Okay? And this is the guy who provided a proof in 1961, Little. And that's why it is named Little's Law. And another thing is that this really does not assume anything about the distributions. Okay? Only assumption is that nobody is killed inside. So you could have any distribution, you could have any dependence, independence, whatever you want, but this will apply as long as nobody is killed. Okay? And the proof is very simple. And the way the proof works is that you stand outside and you find out when the first job came in, the first person came in. So you see the first person came in at 0, time 0, and it left. It left at time 3. Left at time 4. Okay? Second person came at time 3 and left at time 6. Right? So you just plot the arrival and the departure. Then you take the same data and plot it differently. How many people were in the system? At time 1, only one person had gone in, nobody had come out, so we have one person. At time 2, only one person. At time 3, only one person. Now after time 3, we have two people and so on and so forth. You can plot the same data in a different way. Third way you can plot the system is that for each customer, you can find out how long they were in the system. You know that they were even in time 1, 0, came back at 4, this time was 4. Second customer went at 3, but came out at 6. This time was this and that, right? These three areas are identical equal. Okay? If you believe that statement that these three areas are equal, then we can prove the thing that basically the hatched area is basically equal to J, and then we divide by different things to find out the relationship. So mean number in the system, you can find out mean number in the system from this graph. So you take the J, the area J divided by the total time, J upon T is the mean number in the system. Right? That is equal to N upon T times J upon T. N upon T is the arrival rate, basically. Total number divided by total time. And J upon N comes from here, mean time in the system. So this one is the first customer's time, this is the second customer's time. So total area is J, total number of jobs is N. So the average height here is J upon N. So that is the mean number in the system is equal to arrival rate times mean time in the system. All right. Now the second interesting thing is that you can apply it to any system or any part of the system. So if this is your system, you can just apply it to the queues and this works. You can just apply it to the waiting people and it works. You can apply it to the whole thing. Okay? So for example, you can say mean number in waiting here. Mean number waiting is equal to arrival rate times mean waiting time. Similarly, mean number in service, if you apply here, mean number in service is equal to arrival rate times mean service time. If that is the whole thing, you can see the same thing. Mean number in the system equal to arrival rate times the mean response time. Okay? So that's very powerful law. So here is something that we can do with this law now. Reminder, a disk server ensures that the average time satisfied the IO request for 100 milliseconds. The IO rate was about 100 requests per second. What was the mean number of requests at the server? So we are average, we know the response time, 100 milliseconds. We know the arrival rate, 100. So how many requests? So basically, mean number in the server equal to arrival rate times response time. Arrival rate is 100 jobs per second. Response time is 0.1 second. And therefore, the product of the two is 10 requests. So that is the queue length at the disk. All right, since we are doing the quiz, we might as well do the quiz. Remember, n is equal to lambda r, so just calculate whatever you can calculate about n, lambda, and r. I think we are asking for n, so just calculate lambda and r and multiply them. Done? So, the lambda is 120 upon 60. 120 requests were received in 1 minute, so that is 2 per second. R is 1 second. So n is 2. How many will get 2? Okay, all right. So that's okay. So now next go to the stochastic processes. So when we say random number, we know random number what it means, right? Now we are going to talk about processes. That is a little bit more statistics here. So processes means function of time. So if some random number is a function of time, we call it a stochastic process. Okay? And so for example, number of jobs in the queue, in the CPU. Number of jobs you measure right now, is 1 second, it is 2, and it's a random number, but it's a function of time. So that's the process. That's a stochastic process. And and so waiting time is a process. So most of the things that we are talking here, you know, in this part is function of time, and therefore that is a process. There are different special processes that we'll talk about: discrete, continuous state, Markov, and Bernstein and Poisson. So what is a discrete or continuous state process? Discrete, you know what means, is finite or countable. For example, number of jobs in a system cannot be 0.1. It has to be 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's a discrete process. So it's a discrete state process. Waiting time is a continuous process. Waiting time could be 2.3335 seconds, right? So that is a continuous value. When something is discrete state, we call it a stochastic chain. And so for example, this thing is a stochastic chain. No big deal. All right. Then there are discrete and continuous time processes. And so please don't confuse the discrete and continuous time processes with discrete or continuous state process. State means the y value. Time is t. Right. So time might be continuous in most systems, although in computers they are not continuous. In computers, if you really look at it, instructions are done, and then the next instruction and next instruction. So they have the time moves in steps. Right? So it's a discrete time system. However, you know, if you're working on an hourly basis, or daily basis, or yearly basis, the time is almost continuous. So you could model a computer system as a continuous time. But if you're modeling it in nanosecond value, then you will know that the time cannot be 3.2 nanoseconds. It is only, you know, clock time, one cycle. Right? So that is continuous or discrete time. Process is the y-axis. That could be continuous or discrete. When we say state, we mean the y-value. Markov. Markov means basically future states are independent of the past and depend only on the present. So here is another process. We know memoryless means we don't know any more the history, doesn't matter. But if just I told you the currently what is the system, and based upon that you can tell me everything about the future, that is a Markov process. So it just depends upon the current state. So if I told you that there are 8 students in the class, how many will be there next Monday? That kind of prediction will be Markov, because you will just say, well, it doesn't really matter who came to the last class, you know, it's just this class it matters. So Markov means current state is all sufficient to do the next state. Oh, we are done. Okay, so we'll continue on this next time. Okay.